They've won Tonys and Oscars and Emmys and Grammys. There's no red carpet because they're home in their jammies. From Melrose Place to Broadway to Janeway and her crew. Let Seth and James bring all the stars to you.
Anywho,
they're entertaining everyone, so who's gonna grouse? Just sit right back and you'll hear some tales on Stars in the House.
What's up, everybody? As usual, I am neither Seth Rudesky or Nor. I don't know English, or James Wesley. I am, though, however, Sierra Boggess, and I am extremely excited to be hosting again. I think this is like my third or fourth time hosting. What the heck? I don't know why they keep bringing me back, because I have literally no idea what I'm doing. but I love being here for Stars in the House, and I'm like already sweating because I 100,000% love these people that I'm bringing on this show. I cannot even deal. They are three of the most extraordinary top of their field dancers. Like, you can't even, you're just gonna lose your minds. Before we get to that though, little housekeeping, which is, this is Stars in the House. James and Seth started this right at the start of this here quarantine. And so we have been going strong. They have been going strong. They are just giving and giving and giving themselves each night to all of you. And I know how much you love this. And you are also extremely generous people. So what I just got was the number that has been raised, the total that has been raised so far for the Actors Fund. Come on, New York. You know this is live and in New York because, you know, sirens just be going by. So far, to date, you all, with your generosity, have raised $530,000 for the Actors Fund. Woo! That is so extraordinary, and I'm just so grateful for all of your generosity thus far. And please, if you feel compelled, please donate. You see the little scrolling ticker tape at the bottom of the screen. Holy sirens. That's where you donate. Stars in the House, hashtag Stars in the House. Look, guest host me. So please, if you feel so inclined, please donate to the Actors Fund tonight at starsinthehouse.com. So with that being said, I am going to first bring on the extraordinary Tyler Peck, who is kind of the reason that we're all brought together tonight. Because she came up with something really extraordinary and really generous and really awesome and just full of heart and love. I happen to think she's just about the greatest dancer that has ever been. This girl is on point, literally. So I didn't tell her I was going to do this, but I'm going to embarrass her probably. Whatever, it's fine. It's Stars in the House, and I'm hosting. But I just want to bring her on, and then we will talk about a new stage, which is why we're all here. But can you first, I just want to, and David, the amazing behind the scenes, David Angel, will you just play as intro? This is the introduction, y'all, to Tyler Peck. If you haven't seen her dance live, which we are waiting. We can't wait till we can all watch each other do things live in the arts community. This is Miss Tyler Peck. Tyler, you know I had to.
I was like, what tricks does she have up her sleeve? What is she going to show?
I'm like, literally, I'm going through this, like, I could show anything, but I'm like, I have to show you turning. You guys, that was 30 seconds worth of Tyler just turning on one foot. Like, it's not even right. It doesn't make any sense to the human mind.
I think you actually saw me in Swan Lake, no?
I remember. Did. I absolutely saw you in Swan Lake. You helped me get tickets, and you let me come backstage, and I got to take a picture of you in your pretty swan dress.
Yes, the feathers. You got to have the tutu, the whole thing.
So, is that a thing at New York City Ballet? It's like after, because it's very like regimented after the show. It's like you stay on stage in your costume. Like, is that a rule?
You know, it's not. They actually always want you to get out of costume right away. Like, the dresser's always like, Tyler, pick it up. But so many people want to come back, and you know, it's not like Broadway where we do 8 shows, you know, a week of the same show. We will get maybe 2 or 3 performances of Swan Lake. So when you're in that tutu, you want to get photos with your family.
Absolutely. And you've just finished a whole production, so it's like you don't want to be just like sort of like
Exactly. I'm always like, Grace, can my mom will help me get out of the tutu. Can we just keep it on for a little longer? She's like, yeah, it's fine.
Oh, your mom really help you? Does she help you backstage with that?
Yeah, getting in and out of a tutu is not easy. So normally she comes for the big performances. For something like Swan Lake, she was there. And so, you know, you need help getting in. It's like a hook and eye. They're not the most comfortable. They're beautiful, but it's like a bodice.
Yes. And they're also, are they made out of tulle? Like kind of like itchy?
Very itchy.
See, we know.
You're like a closet ballerina for sure. You know way too much about it.
I know. I can't even deal. Wait, Tyler, so everybody, this is Tyler Peck, in case you didn't realize that this is Tyler Peck that we're talking to here and now, live and in person on the screen. Will you just tell everybody how you got started? How all of it, because you truly are so extraordinary, but your story is really interesting, I think, and where you came from. You're not from here. You're from the planet, I think. None of these guests, neither you, Lil Butt Club, I don't think any of you are from here, but we'll go with it.
Okay.
But tell your tales, please.
Okay, well, I'm from Bakersfield, California, which is where my family still lives and where I spent my quarantine. So I was there for 7 months. Which you know because you took my class.
That's right. That is right.
Yes. But my mother was a dancer and she owns a dance studio. So I grew up dancing at her studio. And ballet was my least favorite. Yeah, like I really couldn't stand it. And I would always try to get out of the ballet class because I went to a studio that had everything. Ballet, tap, jazz, like you name it, I did it. Yeah. And I would always say, oh, mom, I'm feeling a little sick today. I don't think I can take ballet. And she would be like, okay, then you can't take jazz. And I'd be like, oh, I think I'm feeling better. But I'm so grateful that she said to me, Tyler, whether you go on to do something in ballet or not, like that's the foundation. Mm-hmm. And she was right. I could never have a career as a ballerina had she not made me keep up with the technique. Yes. But I always thought, honestly, I would be on Broadway because that's what actually took me to New York was when I was 11, I moved for the Music Man on Broadway because growing up in California, I acted, I sang, I of course danced and that's what I thought I would do. And it wasn't until I was in the Music Man that I went to see the Nutcracker with my family because my dad bought us tickets. And during that moment when I was sitting in the audience, I said to my dad, he always reminds me, Daddy, I'm going to dance on that stage someday. Yeah. And so now the fact that I get to be the sugar plum fairy for all of those kids that I know are like me in the audience wanting to do that is it's kind of gives me chills every time. I mean, we do Nutcracker. I've done it for many years, but yeah. I will say that I never get sick of it and I look forward to it each year. So when it was taken away this year, it was really sad. You know, I'm really bummed, as I'm sure so many of us are, that our theaters are dark.
Well, that's what it is. It's so devastating. But just what you talked about, like the devastating thing is, so we can still be doing so. You're dancing, you're finding ways to do what you do, but the live element is missing. The part where the audience is there, where you're doing it for that kid who's never seen it before and is the next, like, Tyler Peck, you know?
No, it's true. It's that audience performer relationship is so special. And, you know, our show is a way to bring it into houses so that it can be a front row seat. But there is nothing that will ever take away that live performing arts quality. And Amen. That's what I'm missing the most, I think, is Amen. That relationship.
Yes. So will you tell us now about a new stage? Tell us.
Yeah. So it came about actually because of Turning Out with Tyler classes and just all of the people that were reaching out to me saying, you know, how much they were missing classes and how they really appreciated getting to like have some structure during the day and keep up their technique and getting to know me as a person. Because I think sometimes as a ballerina, we kind of get put on this like pedestal that's like, oh, maybe they're a diva or they are untouchable. You know, I'm so not like that. So it's been very nice for people to get to see like my personality and, you know, be able to relate to me because this is how I am, you know?
Yes.
And so people really, I gained a lot of friends and bonds through this, and people would write me saying how much they were missing going to the theater and watching a performance. And so here I am, you know, you're the same way. We're like, how are we going to make something happen? Got to always like move forward. And so I thought, look, all of these theaters are dark. The stages are empty. There's got to be a way we can put on a performance on the stage, maybe not with an audience, but bring a live show during the pandemic to viewers. Because I feel like there's been so many beautiful digital seasons that people have been able to watch of previous performances. But I really wanted to bring like new art, something now that we created a very special piece that has never been seen before. And just, you know, for everything to be really relevant right now with what's going on. And so that was really what kind of sparked the whole thing. And I never thought it would happen. And then I went to CLI and I said, what do you guys think? And I know it's kind of crazy, but can we make it happen? And they were like, yeah, let's do it.
So will you say CLI Studios is...
CLI Studios.
Yeah. For those that don't know what CLI Studios, did you have an affiliation with them before all of this?
Yes. They have this amazing platform that is basically education. So they have master classes for so many. Chloe teaches for them too. And yeah, you can talk to her about that. But really the range of dance instructors that they have that they teach for education is amazing. So I had been doing some classes for them over like during the pandemic. And so I thought, hey guys, like let's create some new content and not do a class. Let's make a show.
Yes. Okay. So I want us to play my angel, David, to play the trailer for what we're talking about. So here's the trailer, everybody, for a new stage curated by Miss Tyler Peck.
It a million times and it's still very exciting to me.
I know. Here, it's just like it's so extraordinary. So I want to bring on two of the other incredible artists that are part of this. The first person that I'm going to bring on now is Miss Chloé Arnold, who is an Emmy nominated choreographer, extraordinary oh my God, extraordinary tapper and founder of Syncopated Ladies, who are featured so beautifully in this. And before we bring her on, I got to give her an intro too. So let's take it away with an intro of Chloé. Talking that shit, talking out of her neck, but blood on her dress. If you think that when they see Cardi step in the spot, said that you got it, we know that you're not. I'ma pull up as soon as I drop. Press. Cardi don't need more press. Kill them all, put them to rest. Walk in bulletproof vest. Please tell me who she gon' check. Murder scene, Cardi made a mess. Pop up, guess who?
I wasn't expecting that.
You like just took us to tap church. That was like tap heaven.
Oh my God. I was not ready for that. I thought it was going to be like, a reel or something.
No, not here on Stars in the House. We're just making things happen. This like, haha, you have to watch yourself.
Yes. Oh, I love it. Thank you so much for having me. Hi, Tyler.
Chloé, I feel like we're getting the crew back together.
It's a family reunion.
Wait, so before we go into, I want to know all the connections of Tyler. Like, what made you bring all of these extraordinary people together? How you know each other? But Chloé, will you also first tell everybody, because I just love this, and so for me personally, but for everybody listening, how did you get started? What made you want to do this?
Well, I was, kind of, like Tyler was saying, like I was in a studio. For me, it was like a small studio in like a strip mall, one room. We took ballet, tap, jazz. I actually have a video of me taking ballet at the bar when I'm like 6 or 7. I'm in fifth. I do a susu the wrong way. My legs get caught up in each other. That was the end of the ballet career. It's like, I did keep taking ballet, but it was clear that tap, I was much better. My videos, I'm like hitting it, I'm in the pocket. So my mom recognized that rhythm and tap were my thing. And so from a very young age, she looked for opportunities. And it was just honestly great timing for me because the movie Tap came out when I was 9. And then Gregory Hines came to DC, which is where I'm from. So I got to see him live, perform live and take a class. And then that was that. Then I was like, this is what I want to do. So that's how it started. And I've just had the most incredible humans in my life guiding me and inspiring me. And Debbie Allen is honestly the greatest of them all because she helped me find how my love for tap could be amplified and how my knowledge of other styles of dance could augment and complement the way that I express myself as a tap dancer.
Wow. I mean, doesn't get better than that. That Debbie Allen's like, hey, I see something in you.
Yeah, she's the greatest.
Yeah, that's amazing. And then how did Syncopated Ladies come about?
So when I was in college, I went to Columbia, and while I was in school, I was like, had this vision, like I'm going to be on Broadway and I'm going to be in this show and this show. My vision and reality were not connected in that moment because all of the shows that were happening only had male tap dancers as featured performers. So if you wanted to be a female tap dancer on a show, you had to be in the chorus. But I was training at a level and a rigor that I felt like I could be a lead. So I realized it wasn't happening. Mm-hmm. And so Debbie Allen actually suggested I move to LA. She thought I could create there. And she gave me studio space to create Syncopated Ladies in 2003. And now 17 years later, we're living our dreams and working together and just share a sisterhood. 17 years together is literally like they're my sisters. They're not just people I dance with. They are my sisters.
Yes. And did you all know each other? Did you? Go ahead.
All through Debbie Allen Dance Academy. So they were my students at Debbie Allen. So like when I started it, one of them was 11. Anissa was 11. Melinda was 14. Maude was in high school. I mean, these were children. And I was like, hey girls, want to be a Matat crew? And then, you know,
yes.
it took 10 years of us like actually growing up to then be like professional. But it's just been amazing because we've grown together. And it's honestly thanks to Debbie Allen's scholarship programs that all of them were able to train and that I had a space to create.
That is so extraordinary. And for everybody, syncopatedladies.com, you can see, and just on YouTube, it's like, yeah, there you go.
Thank you.
You can see these incredible, fierce women just tapping their faces off and performing their faces off. It's just like, it really is everything. It's so extraordinary. It just fills me with so much joy. There, look at these syncopated ladies.
Bam.
So look at these stills, you guys. These are stills for everybody watching from what you will see in a new stage when you can stream this on Friday, which is so exciting. I can't wait. Look at that.
It's so exciting. Tyler, really, thank you. Thank you, my sister. This is, you know, the world is testing us, right? Mm. The universe is testing our grit, our resilience, and how we relate to one another. And Tyler, you gave us such a beautiful platform. You're sharing your platform, which is very important, everybody out there in the world, to know that when we share and open our arms and our doors and our stage to others, you know, there's a great saying, when you light a path for others, you light a path for yourself. And Tyler, I think that's why you're so happy, because you're glowing, but you want others to glow too. And that's really special.
Thank you. That was so nice. I love that. And I love that saying, and it's so true. And that's what I would say about you. Like, both of you guys, I swear, are like boss chicks, and I respect it so much. And I just love everything that you both are about. And with your syncopated ladies, I just feel like it's so important to see five strong women with amazing voices that need to be heard. And honestly, I was sitting in the audience and I could not contain the like clapping I wanted to so bad. We had to wait till the cut, but I can't wait for everybody to see what you guys did. Like it's incredible.
I'm really, really proud. And you know what makes me most proud too, is that all of us will have this in history forever. When we look back at this very unique time, this will be something that we cherish. This is like a time capsule of our mind, spirit, and just our strength.
Absolutely right. That is so absolutely right. It's what we're doing with this time that is so important. And we are being tested. We have been pushed as far down as we can, maybe even farther, because I'm like, never say never with 2020. It ain't over yet. Some stinging caterpillars or something. It was like murder hornets and all this, and now it's like a stinging caterpillar. Look out. It's like, what? Like, even a cute caterpillar is like, you never know. But yes, absolutely all of those things. Oh, okay, so let's bring on our awesome little Buck, you guys. Yes. Here comes little Buck. He's been dancing since he was 13 years old. He's from Memphis, Tennessee. He has been collaborating with artists that are like up and coming, like Madonna and Spike Lee. Like, what the heck? I don't even know. It's out of this world, the way that he moved his body. Ladies and gentlemen, of course, here's an intro video. Lil Buck.
Fight for my own strength, cracking through the pavement, born to see. My skeleton of stone, my heart a burning bone, my rapturous tone, my aching for home, my dance upon my tomb, my butterfly wings I've sown, my aching for home.
Intro.
Oh,
y'all loved your intro. I was like, you better cut.
That is not
exactly that. That is what is a little buck. Oh my gosh. I am so honored, first of all. And again, now I have to thank Tyler too for including me in a new stage, because I can't believe that I get to be in a thing like a, I don't even know what to call it, a straight, like what it, what are these
things? Like the Brady Bunch box. Like I want to look up and look over.
And I'm looking down. That's what's up. And then this and here. Yes. Okay, Lil Buck, will you tell us how you got started? Share your story. It's so awesome.
Yes. Well, thank you for having me, ladies. And I got started in dance when I was, around the age of, I've been dancing for as long as I can remember. Me and my sister used to just grow up watching dance. My older sisters, one of my older sisters, she was a dancer. She was a majorette, actually. And I don't know if you know what a major, like, you know, in the South, they have majorettes. She was a majorette, and she used to twirl a baton, and she was the captain of her team, and she used to get it in. So I always looked up to her as a dancer in general, because she was always dancing. So I grew up dancing with her. And we grew up just watching Michael Jackson videos.
Yeah.
Like we got a hold of one of his tours on VHS. I know you young kids don't know about VHS these days, but we got a hold of one of Michael Jackson's tours, and we religiously watched his tour performance until we could actually learn the choreography from just watching it on, you know, from the cassette. And I've been in love with dance ever since I've seen Michael Jackson do that. And then, I'm originally from, like, I was born in Chicago, and my family moved to Memphis when I was 8 years old, when I was very young. So when we moved to Memphis, this is when I started to, you know, I never knew anybody can move like Michael, right? I never knew anybody can move like this man. I thought he was just a mythical, just godly dancer that, like, you just had to be Michael Jackson to hit that level. You had to be somebody, like, I don't know. And just an obtainable level. And you know, growing up in Memphis, I've seen, you know, I grew up to see this dance style called Memphis Jukin that originated in a city. And they're young kids, you know, 12 years old, 13, 15, you know, of all ages, gliding across the concrete like it was water, you know, like it was nothing. And to grow up in this environment and seeing a lot of, you know, young kids and a lot of people who look like me and my age and, you know, dressing like me and my whole environment, to be able to move like that and have access to that type of, you know, artistry, I was just astounded. You know, I was just shocked. So I fell in love at first sight, you know, with that style of dance. And that's when I was around the age of, you know, 12, 13, when I really said, this is what I want to do. You know, I knew it was something that I loved growing up watching Michael Jackson do. But when I started to see my peers in my city, you know, actually doing it and be able to obtain this type of talent and you know, and learn, you know, themselves through the art of street dance. I just, you know, it was hook, line, and sinker. I couldn't get out of it. It was something I just fell in love with.
And how do you learn something like that too? Because you are learning from watching, but then how do you practice it? Because it's so, like, how you move. You do. You look like, you know what I feel like you look like is an ice skater. Like, even when
it's funny you say that, I get a lot of influence from ice skating and ice skaters and all types of forms of movement. So it's a dance style that you can learn. It's very learnable. There's a lot of discipline that comes with it. There's a lot of training. There's a lot of practicing as you would do with ballet or as you do with jazz or as you do with tap. It's more than just, you know, a lot of people, it's an improv based dance. So it's based around like your own creativity, but it also has a lot of foundation in its base, you know, and fundamentals that you have to learn to make it what it is. So there's a lot of practice that goes into it. There's a lot of hours that we put into it, you know, not in the studio per se, but you know, we spend a lot of hours in our garages or in our carports or out in the parking lots or with our peers, you know, practicing away, recording ourselves, looking at ourselves, fixing ourselves. So we have to be the teacher and the student a lot of times. And, you know, in learning this dance style yourself and trying to develop who you are personally, you know, and finding your uniqueness through the style. So it's something that you can learn, but it's also something that you can really learn more about yourself with. And the more you learn about yourself as a dancer, I think the more free you can become in your movement. So that's the whole beauty of, you know, Memphis Juking and a lot of different dance styles out there like that. You know, tap is the same. There's a lot of different dance styles that, you know, you can really, you know, that has that room for, you know, finding your unique way of movement. Even, you know, Tyler has her own unique way of doing what she does. That's why she's Tyler Peck, right?
That's right.
You know, so that's the beauty of dance. And that's one of the beautiful things about Memphis Juking that I, you know, just grasp. And I'm just so happy I fell in love with at a young age and was able to, you know, just really, you know, hone in on this craft, because that's what it is. We're, you know, we're craftsmen and women.
Yes. Oh. Come on. That is everything. I want to know how, because you all are the top of your field. And I love how you are, have all these types of dance represented. Everybody is at the top of their field. How did you come to know each other? How did this connection happen?
I knew Tyler through for a while. Like, I was introduced to Tyler through, I think it was Damian Wetzel, right? They kind of brought us together.
It was at Vail Dance Festival.
So I first met Tyler at the International Dance Festival in Vail, Colorado. And that's when, you know, this is, you know, I've always been a fan of different types of, you know, artists. But to get to see like the top of the top, like you say, like the Chloé Arnolds of tap and the Tyler Pecks of ballet, you know, it was just, you know, amazing. When I first, you know, saw Tyler and saw her get down, I was just amazed, you know. I wanted to just grab her and be like, let me teach you some of these secrets I got. But, you know, it was amazing because Tyler can learn anything. Like, a lot of people don't know about Tyler. She can learn whatever you give her. And she's such a, you know, she's just such a vessel and a sponge for dance in general. A lot of people might not know that about her, but that's one of the things I really love about Tyler, you know, that she's such a sponge when it comes to dance, and she can absorb and she can learn, you know, a lot of different things outside of, you know, ballet. I love it.
I know, that's like with you both, with Chloé and Lil Buck, I'm like, you know, I can't tap. I'm horrible. And we just made that little video, and I'm like, you just make up what would be right for tap, and then I'll try to put my little ballet spin on it. And with Lil Buck, I'm like, teach me something. I want to learn how to juke. Like, teach me something, and let's see if I can figure it out. Because, Buck, you dance on point.
Yes,
like, yeah. You do. It's incredible. And your arms are, like, the best.
Look at that.
Yes.
Yes, beautiful.
On point, yes. And beautiful. You've got the best swan arms out of all of us. You got to be doing the swan queen.
I got to put some point shoes my size, you know?
I think that the sneakers are a lot more comfortable.
I bet.
They are.
You're winning.
I think they might be, you know.
But that's what you need to do. You need to create a sneaker point shoe.
Hey, you gotta, you know, yeah, keep that on the hush. I got this stuff going on, you know. I got you, Ty. I got you.
Yeah, and I think I think I met. So I saw a video. I'm not sure. I think I saw it before I met you, Buck. The video of you in the museum.
I
don't know why I had to do this.
I think we met. I feel like we met somewhere like in Vegas or something. Like I saw you.
You know what?
I used to live in Las Vegas because I worked with Cirque du Soleil, and I remember the syncopated ladies perform in some hotel. I forget which hotel. Yes. But I saw y'all get down, and I was like, "Let's go!"
Yes, yes, like, it was Vegas. It was Vegas. Vegas
when we first met.
Yep. But when I saw your, you have no idea. When I saw that video, I started pitching you for TV things and like sending that video out. Yeah, I was like, "You gotta see him." Yeah, see him rock. And then Tyler, we met in a car ride from the airport to Vail.
Vail as well. Yes.
It was like, I feel like we had a one night only type of thing. I don't know. I feel like it was a blur.
And we didn't work together. I always wanted to work with Chloe. Same with you, Sierra. Like, we've never worked together. I've always just been waiting for the opportunity. And so this was so amazing because I was like, here, the stars are aligning, our schedules are free, like, let's make it happen.
Yes. Okay, hold all thoughts. There's so much. We're gonna bring on Dr. John LaPook right now to talk to the people about why we all have this time off. Because there is a virus. So John LaPook is gonna talk. And then we're going to come back. So don't go anywhere. Everybody listen to John LaPook. He knows lots of things. And all of us just stay put because we are going to come back to this very soon. So Dr. LaPook, if you want to come on, we are ready for you.
There we go. There was something with my mic. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Hi.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm better for seeing you, and I'm better for seeing everybody else. And Tyler Peck, hello. We bump into each other here and there, but not for the past pandemic.
Yeah, because she's been away. She's been quarantining in California very, very smartly with
that is the past pluperfect pandemic. It sounds like a part of speech or something like that.
Dr. LaPook, what do you have for us? What's the news?
Well, first of all, I'll give you, you'll be the first to know this, that this truly, I hope it's not saying it too soon, but what the heck. This Sunday, I'm going to have a 60 Minutes piece about COVID-19. So, there will be a very special, I'm going through my head, is it too soon to be saying this? Oh, what the heck? Tony Fauci. I interviewed Tony Fauci, and then I interviewed him. You'll see a part of Tony Fauci that you haven't seen before. I interviewed him alone. I interviewed him with his wife, Christine Grady, who's amazing, amazing person, works for the NIH and is an ethicist, bioethicist. And you'll hear his thoughts about everything from which way are we going and would he take a vaccine and how is he going to vote and all these things. But I will tell you that in terms of the news of the day, so that's this coming Sunday on such 60 Minutes, I will tell you that the news is not good right now in terms of the country. You know, there are new highs throughout the country. We're setting record growth again. And it's not just us, it's, you know, in UK and France. And the thing is, this is what we were afraid of, that the cold weather, so the respiratory viruses, which coronavirus is, likes the cold and the dry. So as we go indoors, we're going to be together on each other. And if there's one thing that everybody should remember, it's wear the mask, because we now know that number one, masks work. Number two, you have to wear them even if you have no symptoms, because about half of the people spread the virus without having symptoms. Three, indoors, this is all brand new, although on it Stars in the House. We were talking about it over the weekend, but now the CDC has officially said that these tiny little droplets, these aerosolized droplets, can travel farther than 6 feet. You know, 6 feet is the magic number.
Yes.
In an indoors, especially if it's poorly ventilated, past the 6 feet, they can go all the way out. And so they can build up. Think about cigarette smoke, how it can float away. If you're 20 feet away from somebody and you're in the room for a half hour, you're going to smell the smoke? Yeah, you'll probably smell it in 10 minutes. So what that says for people is that the old rule that we were hearing is, as long as you're 6 feet away from somebody, you don't need the mask. That's really turning out not to be true indoors. Outdoors, it's a lot safer than indoors, but it's cold.
Yeah.
So if you're indoors, open a window, crack a door, you know, these air purifiers, especially ones with humidifiers. So there was an article out today that what happens is when you humidify the air, the viral particles get heavier, and so they drop to the ground quicker. Yeah. So they're less likely to float out. You heard it here first. So I think, you know, people are making this false equivalency saying either open up the economy or you shut down completely, you know. And actually, the way we're going to open up the economy is by following these public health measures. It's not like public health on the one hand and the economy on the other hand. If we wash our hands and maintain social distancing and open the windows and wear the masks and avoid crowds and do not go to an indoor bar. Mm. When you're indoors at a bar, it's noisy, so you go closer. You talk louder. You don't have a mask on, of course, because you're drinking, so you talk a little louder. And the louder you talk, the more these little tiny aerosols come out. And, of course, they're going to be most within 6 feet, because the closer you are, the more these aerosols will come out, but they can also float across the room. So it actually shouldn't make people depressed. It's just like, oh, I actually have some degree of control over this. So
yeah, that's really helpful. John Lippert for president. Wow. He's like, no, God.
Oh my God. In my worst nightmare.
But you're absolutely right. That shouldn't depress people. It should empower us, that it's like, we are getting good information where we can. That's like, cause we know that we aren't a collective right now getting good information, but hearing these things is extremely helpful. Coming back to New York and seeing that everybody, even outside, is wearing a mask, it just feels like, so you feel safe, you feel like we're in this together, that it's not just, oh, what do we do, wearing a mask.
And you need to cover your nose too. The mask that goes under here.
Yes, please remind us how one should wear a mask.
Yeah, wear over the nose. And, you know, I have this little redness here because I'm wearing an N95 mask when I'm seeing patients. So I still see internal medicine patients. And, you know, it's really uncomfortable. I have to confess that I just hate it, you know, having this mask and then the shield. You got to do it to be safe. But you want to connect with your patients, and they're wearing a mask and you're wearing a mask. And so maybe we're learning a little bit more about what goes on here.
Yeah.
But I think it is a good time for people to acknowledge that, yes, we're having COVID fatigue. It's been a long time. We're kind of in the middle of it still. But I'm very confident there will be a vaccine by the beginning of next year. That's going to make a difference. Better masks are coming. I'm. It's very cool what the research there, you know, nanoparticle masks that's going to fit to your face better. Maybe they'll look clear so you could actually see through them and you wear some goggles. And that, plus the vaccine, plus better ventilation, plus doing all the other things. But I think people should acknowledge that if they're feeling sad now, they're feeling anxious, to don't just keep it like this, to reach out to your friends. And in fact, anybody out there watch right now, we'll just make it one. Think of one person who might be alone, who might not have gotten a call today. And after this is over, give them a call. Mm-hmm. It makes all the difference in the world, because, you know, when they do experiments about being in control, locus of control, stuff like that, the way to make somebody feel depressed is to give them sort of like an animal experiment, to put them in situations where they're totally out of control and there's nothing they can do to make things better. That's kind of how a lot of us feel right now, right? We're it's, you know, we like to be in control, right? Especially people who are performers, right?
Yes. Like, yes.
Control. You can't just get on the stage and go, well, whatever, right?
That's right. Thank you so much for talking about also the mental health aspect of it too, and how important it is that we are connecting with people as we are in these, we're connecting now with this part. We have our mouths covered, our noses covered, and just all of that. Oh, awesome. You're getting a lot of love from the internet, Dr. LaPook. Thank you so much.
You're so welcome. And say hello. And Tyler, wait, to bring Tyler on for one second.
I was wondering if I was going to get to say hi.
Hi, how are you?
Good. It's so nice to see you and hear that, because I still feel like we just don't have all this information, and I want to like have more. So yes. Thank you. I was like listening religiously.
Well, Aniqua, they can give you all my private contact info if you have specific questions. I'm happy to do that. But you have been providing me with such pleasure, because of course I follow you, and oh my gosh, all your little dancing around that last one where you're doing a. Oh, you know, I thought of a ballet pun, actually. It's not to be too personal, but are you in like a pas de deux?
A pas de deux? What does that mean?
A pas, you know, people are in their own bubbles or pods. You know,
No, but we were in a group pas de deux for these shows.
A pod de catch. However many there were, but anyway.
A pas de deux, yeah. No, we had to be very careful with these shows. We made sure that, you know, when we did this, that everybody was quarantined, wore the mask. The crew had the mask the entire time. Sierra and I were in the room together for one rehearsal and then filmed it. And anybody who flew, they self-quarantined, got tested. So we did. I think you would have been proud with how much we put safety into the show.
And remember that, you know, because I have a bunch of people asking me about this, that when you do get together like that, remember that the incubation period is 2 to 14 days. So somebody comes in and they get tested 4 days later, they could still test positive. So you've got to be really careful about that. And especially as a dancer, when you're in that enclosed area, open some windows.
Yes.
It makes the aerosol scientists have proven this. You know, it just dilutes the particles, the aerosol, so much more quickly. So crack a door, open a window, all that stuff.
It's good information. I'm glad that we had this little chat.
I'm glad we had this time together.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. LaPook.
So everybody
watch him on 60 Minutes on Sunday.
Yeah, 60 Minutes this Sunday.
Yes. Thank you. Isn't that so informative?
Oh, it's so nice. I just love getting information.
I know, just getting the info. Yes. All right, come on back. All you have to do is yell.
Yeah.
It's like magic.
We're back.
Like, it's so good to just get a collective bunch of information about what the heck,
mm-hmm. right?
And about the dancing and like just opening a window and just keeping the air and all that stuff. It's just so good.
Mm-hmm. And I would like to just add,
yeah,
these conversations are really important, particularly about mental health. And, you know, everybody, artists, art is our healing. Right. Yeah. So in this tough time for all of us, you know, just dancing, like the minute you start dancing or singing, you know, your spirit is truly lifted. And so I just, you know, that reminder of like reaching out to somebody is awesome, but also get up and dance. Like if your body is like feeling heavy and sad and down, literally get up, turn a song on and dance. And that it will change your life. And if you can even do that exercise once a day, ideally all day for us, but you know, it will really bring you so much joy. And I think it's the greatest gift we can share during this time.
Chloé, thank you so much for saying that. That's something that I wanted to, I know that all of our friends that are fellow artists are really struggling, especially right now, because we don't have places where we can perform and where we can do this. But as as we all have gotten to do collectively with this, a new stage that everybody can watch on Friday, y'all. We can put that link up too, I think, David. CLIstudios.com/a new stage.
Yeah. CLI is so awesome. They, to me, they have just led the way for dance to keep going. Like the week that we hit quarantine, they were like, bam, we're not gonna be alone. We're gonna stay connected. We're gonna create a community online. And I'm so thankful to be a part of it.
It's so good. So everybody knows now you can check out in classes, just like Chloé was saying, get up and dance, move your body. If you need help, there are ways, there are places. Tyler's class as well. She's teaching ballet, you guys. I have taken ballet in quarantine with Tyler Peck. Like, what in the heck? I would never be brave enough to go to any class. First of all, they would never be like, hey, anyone just come on in, you know. But that's what's so cool is that we're getting to dance with people that it's like that we're inspired by and that help us want to be better and grow. And you don't have to worry of like, am I slowing anyone down, because it's your time. So also I just want to highlight that the reason that this show, A New Stage, was created was for exactly what we're talking about, isn't it? Of just a way to express ourselves, a way to dance and connect and get to do this all together in a way that we wouldn't necessarily get to do. So it's like a little gift of this time, a little gift of 2020.
100%. It's all the access, you know, and that's what, you know, a lot of people can get from, like, just having that access to, you know, be able to see your favorites, you know, like Tyler Peck and Chloé Arnold and you know, a Lil Buck and Brooklyn Mac and, you know, all these different superstars of dance all in one room. And I mean, on one stage, and to have this access, that's been one of the beautiful parts about, you know, this, that we can get out of this whole pandemic, you know, that, you know, we're not as busy as we used to. So now we can be able to socialize and create more for people out there, and to create more access to, you know, who we are as artists to people out there. So, yeah, I really had so much fun doing, you know, doing this, this performance, and I'm really excited about, you know, when it releases.
Yes,
I want to make sure that people know that Friday is not the only day that you can watch it. That is going to be like our opening night, right? But for those of you who can't watch it on Friday at a specific time, once you get your ticket, that ticket doesn't expire. So you have a front row seat whenever you want to watch it. So make sure and get your ticket, because I promise you won't. Ticket. Well,
yes,
I hope you won't just be disappointed.
No one can be disappointed. Thank you for saying that, Tyler, that this is something that you get that ticket, you can watch it anytime. And front row seats, y'all.
Yes.
Oh, look at the people are riding. You've lifted our spirits. Thank you. Before I ask us the closing thing, I want to just read out, because thank you for everybody who's donating as we are on this little show tonight. I'm just calling out a few people. David from California gave $25. Your skaters rock. He says, and Tyler, thank you for keeping an old man at the bar through the pandemic.
Oh, honestly, seeing the different types of people that are in this class has been so rewarding, you know, really. And that's what I love. I would never have access to teach so many people if we were in a physical studio. So the fact that I get to have, you know, people in India dancing and, you know, Iran, and then, like he said, you know, a 40-year-old man who's just now starting. I taught somebody that, you know, was 60 years old, used to dance, and now she's just getting back into it. And that's just been amazing to see.
Oh, it's so awesome. Now we have Amy from New York gave $103. And that was in tribute to the amazing Tyler. She said she could turn like that when she was 14.
I might have been better at 14. No, I'm kidding. Well, don't you, really could turn.
But don't you all find this? It's like as we get older, the more like self-doubt creeps in. Cause like when you're like a teen, you're like, sure, I'll do it, you know.
Yeah, I could do more, but were they as good? You know, that's what's gotten better.
Mm-hmm. Polished.
Yeah, exactly. I feel good knowing that I can, you know, I try to wake up in the morning and I feel good knowing that I can fold myself into a pretzel. And I'm trying to see how many years I can go with doing that. Yes. And I'm in a good place right now.
Yeah. I think we all have our markers of what
I love that. It's the coolest thing to see us all from different worlds. And that's what this show is. You know, I wanted to, my biggest thing is to, you know, dream up talents and bring in a group of people from different disciplines and put us together and then what comes out of it. Like, that's what's exciting to me. And so that's what this show is. And getting to be and share the stage and create with all of you has just been such an honor, and I just cannot wait for everybody to see. I'm so proud of it and excited that we did it.
Me too. Our last person that I'm calling out is BJ from Toledo, Ohio. Gave $50. Jeez. I watched Sierra in the 25th anniversary of Phantom of the Opera this past weekend on The Show Must Go On. Great job, baby. Great job, me. Thank you so much, BJ. That's so generous and awesome. And I am so grateful to all of you who have been donating tonight. And please continue to. It goes to the Actors Fund and all of us behind the scenes, on stage. We all benefit from that. And you know, we are all of us. We are struggling because our industry is going to be one of the last things to come back. It blows my mind that we aren't being even considered as essential when all of pandemic, everyone is relying on art. Everyone is watching something, moving, all of the things, just like you said, this, like, if you feel low, get up and move, dance, like all of this stuff. And
yes,
so
when people need it most right now, they need art to escape, and it really is healing.
Yeah. So my final question for everybody, will each of you just speak on what is there something, just, you've all said so many amazing things, and I'm just so honored to be on this screen with you and to be just part of a new stage with you as well. And I look forward to when we come back and I can watch everyone live on stage. Mm-hmm. But will you just speak to the artist, fellow artists, and also anybody who is a young person who is also in the middle of training or wanting to do, to be a dancer? What would you just want to tell each of them as just like, just of how to keep going during the time, or just anything? Start anywhere.
I'll start. I'll just say that that really is truly who I've been feeling for the most is, you know, it sucks for us, but we've also had a career. Like, for those just starting out, it's a little bit scarier. Like, what am I going to do? And the only thing I can think of is, like, when you're at your lowest, right? So last year I just came back from this huge injury, and the dancer that emerged after that was so much different and better. And so what I will say is that, yes, we cannot pretend this really does suck, but you're going to be able to bring all of this experience into your artistry. And I really do feel that it's going to make you mature as a person and show in either your dancing or whatever art you're singing. Like, you're going to be able to bring those experiences to the stage. That's, I think.
That's so good. It makes me want to weep. It's absolutely.
But it's true, right? It's, you know? Yeah.
That's absolutely beautiful. Like, I'd say for me, and this is something that I've spent a lot of time doing, just growing up, you know, and not having the means to actually even get into a studio when I was younger, you know what I mean? And having to, you know, if it's one thing that I did, that helped me grow during times of, you know, during hard times and times of hardship and times like this that truly suck for us performing artists and dancers, is just really using this time to invest a lot into myself. You know what I mean? Like, this is a great moment to invest in yourself as a dancer, invest in your, you know, in your creativity, invest in the time that you're spending, you know, towards, you know, what you love to do. Really, you know, like Chloé said earlier, really get, you know, we use this time now to get up and dance more than ever, you know, like a lot of us that do have careers in dance, you know, like, for example, for me, I'm on the move all the time. I'm working and thinking towards work all the time. But when I really have time to really invest into my craft and who I am and my as a performing artist and as a dancer, that's when you, like Tyler, you come out a totally different person. Like she said, you come out a totally different person, a much stronger dancer. You come out with a, you know, with, you know, more awareness of who you are and your goals. So use this time to invest in yourself. And your and what you want for your future, you know, when things do get back on track, and yeah, just, you know, never dream, you know, your dreams can't be, you know, it's impossible for your dreams to be too big, you know. Like I wanted to be a background dancer when I grew up, you know what I mean? I thought they made millions of dollars, so that was my one big dream. And to be able to accomplish everything I've accomplished, you know, you know my dream, and to see, you know, how, you know, you just go for it, you know, dream as big as you want, and use this time right now that, you know, we can't spend with each other or working as much as we used to invest into yourself as an artist.
That's so good. I'm just gonna cry the rest of the evening. I'm just like, it's so good. Thank you so much for saying all that. Come on, Animal.
This is Animal Kingdom right now.
My cat.
Little Buck, that was beautiful. Tyler, that was beautiful. I think much like Buck, I had, you know, I grew up with very few financial resources. So what's unique about this moment, let's, you know, we have to be real. The pandemic hits lower income families a lot harder. And so what's beautiful about this time is there is an equalizer called the internet that if you can get your hands on it, which is still not everybody can, but if you can, you do have free classes out there to hone your skills, but not just hone your skills, create new community. Find a mentor, find a new friend. I've seen so many beautiful relationships come about because of these online classes. So, you know, it can feel tedious, but that's, it's all about your perspective. So it's about shifting your perspective to not feeling like, oh, I'm behind the screen, but rather what community can I be a part of or can I create to expand in ways that I wouldn't normally be able to. And the beautiful thing is it doesn't take a lot of money to do that because we're all on Instagram and that thing is free. And you can go ahead and send a DM and say, hey, I'm dreaming this. And you know, the more you share your dreams out loud, the more likely they are to happen. Yes. So, you know, again, like Buck said, don't dream small, dream huge. Say the wildest things. I said, I'm going to work with Beyonce. Well, okay, everybody said that, you know, but when I say I put it on my vision board, I feel like I spiritually manifested it because also alignment of my purpose. It wasn't like, I just want to work with Beyonce because she's famous, but rather like, I feel like she is my soul sister. And so we speak the same language, you know what I mean? So I think first thing is imagine it, write it down, share it, speak it out loud, create it. It might not be exactly how good you think it should be. That's okay. Create it, share it, train, skills, 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 build them. But what Tyler and Buck were saying, which is so important, is that your life story is who you are as an artist. So the adversity you face becomes the expression in the work, and then it's more full and it's more rich because you actually have experienced something in life.
Oh my God, this is just overwhelming. Actually, it's overflowing with inspiration. That's what it's doing. It is just like, I feel like we need to get up and dance for now.
Just like, yeah, it's time.
It's everything. Thank you all so much for sharing your stories and your talent and your words. And for everybody watching, these artists, you know, I've given little intros that say, here's what they can do. But then we talk because here's who you are. Here's the human behind this incredible dancing ability. But as all of you have spoken about, it's like each of you is at the top of your field and who you are because of the soul work that you're bringing to it as well. And it's just so evident in watching each of you dance. It is, what a gift. And so once again, everybody, CLIstudios.com/a new stage. There it is. It's on all of our Instagrams, y'all. There's the photos that'll make you want to go there. Come on. Look at this. We will be, oh, look at that.
Oh, look at that. Woo.
Look at that. Come on. Look at that.
Goodness.
Oh, it's just everything. This is so.
Yes, okay.
Come on, girl. And there is Tyler Peck, who started this whole thing, whose brainchild this was. And we are all so grateful to you, Tyler. And we cannot wait to share this with all of you. So don't forget, on Friday is when you can start watching it, but you can watch it at any time. But get your tickets now. That's what's so great. Like, tickets aren't going to run out. You don't have to worry. We all get front row. Equalizer.
Hello.
All right. So thank you all so much again. I'm so grateful to all of you. I'm honored to be with you on this. I can't wait for everybody to see this. Thank you. Thank you.
And thank you.
And to take us out, let us have another trailer to get people excited about a new stage.
I'm coming in. I'm coming in.